Well, next we've got Fatou Sow, who is the director of Women Living Under Muslim Laws. She's a Senegalese sociologist, a member of a number of African and international associations, including a founder member of Le Groupe de Recherche sur les Femmes et la Loi au Sénégal. She's an international director of Women Living Under Muslim Laws, a solidarity network that provides information, support, and a collective space for women whose lives are shaped, conditioned, or governed by laws and customs said to derive from Islam. Okay, Fatou.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. I think I owe you an apology. I usually speak fast in French, but I control French. I am a Francophone. And it's worse in English because my words are running after my ideas. I'm trying to put them together, so once in a while it's a bit difficult. So these are the only apologies I owe you. And as it is difficult to just to, in 10 minutes, read or speak about my presentation, I hope it will be published one day. I will just take key points. First of all, I'm glad to be here because this is a non-academic conference. For 40 years in my life, I have been an academic, teaching at universities, and being in conferences where you are required scientific objectivity. Meaning you have to be polite when you agitate ideas. For instance, when I write on women and whatever it is very difficult to have a feminist approach because on my campus in Senegal, to be feminist means to be Western, which is any sort of blackmail. Because you want to be African and want to be feminist and want to say the rights of women. And it is even worse today on my campus in Dakar, where it is very difficult also to be to claim yourself as a secular. While Senegal is a secular state, because we were granted secularism, and I'll talk about it in 2 minutes, but there was no challenge of discussing about secularism. But today it's very difficult to say you are secular, because if you are secular, it means you don't believe in God, which is, I don't care, that's fine with me, but it's very difficult with students, and so this is the context of challenge. I have been in Paris for 10 years at University Paris Diderot, where it was easy for me to be a feminist, but it was also difficult to be, not difficult to be secular, But both combinations were quite difficult because me, as an African woman, I was subject of topic of ethnology, anthropology, cultural anthropology, and what I suffered the most was to be part of cultural relativism. So there was many challenges in doing work on women, on women in religion, women in the state, and on secularism. So this is that's why I feel very happy to be here and to be able to talk really what I have in my, should I say, guts. So as a citizen of independent secular state, I must say that I inherited, as many Senegalese and many West African people coming from former French colonies, of laicity. I'm going to speak about laicity because this is a word I understand. Secularism is too complicated, and I don't want to be complicated translating from English to French when I'm translating from Wolof to French or French to Wolof, which is my native language. But what we had in France, what we inherited from France was laicity, but a rearranged laicity. What I say, a laïcité reprogrammée. It means that the French who preach for the separation between religion and the state, with all the complications that Mayeme and Nadia talked about earlier, when you come in countries, and West Africa, I'm speaking of West Africa, Senegal and Mali, countries which were Muslim since the 11th century, going in several centuries to construct Islam in their societies. I think it was very difficult for the French to bring secularism in countries who, when they became colonized by the French, used Islam as an identity. Because otherwise, your tribal culture, your ethnic culture, your ethnicity for the French were not valued. But Islam was something that the French could understand and could, entre guillemets, respect. So people use the Islamic, their Muslim identity as a tool of resistance, political resistance, cultural resistance, and religious resistance. So it meant that when the French put secularism, laïcité in many of the laws, when it came to family laws, then they allowed Islam to rule. And they allowed Muslim courts to take care of inheritance, marriage, divorce. So we are, even if we were a secular state, it was a dual system in which, for example, I was married in 1971 on coutume wall of Islamized Muslim custom, while other people were married under the Code Napoleon. So that's what I mean when we say about, when we talk about secularism, about laïcité. But what was important is that laïcité was a basic principle, a principle that people accepted, because in the Constitution, in the Penal Code, in many of the laws that are ruling the country, religion is nowhere except in the family code. And that was problematic. So the two cases I wanted to discuss about, but I don't have the time, were Senegal and Mali. And those two countries, which were former French colonies, became independent in 1960 at the 3 months joint venture of a federal country, got split 3 months later in 1960. But both of those countries have a constitution in which it is written that laïcité is one of the basic principles. And that basic principle, for 3 to 4 decades, people tried to deal with it. It was a sort of very complex system, but at least we knew that secularism was there. But with the revival of Islamic discourses, I'm not going to say worldwide, but in many countries that we are concerned with, then the resistance that people had and trying to have a secular state started to be fragmented and trying to be politically subversive into the principle of laïcité. And I think that for the 21st year that where we had Senghor, who was Christian as the president, we were able to have a family code in which Islam was one of the source of the law, but at least people could discuss about a laïc, a system which was laïc, which was very difficult in Mali because they were unable to construct a family code being a laic one. So they had something which was made of several little laws but they still had to make it more progressive. And when Mali did it in 2009, when the country was independent since 1960 and had sort of family law in 1962, the family law that put in many international conventions that we had for 30 years of women's fight for their rights, became totally jeopardized by Muslim organization. And just one point that I wanted to say in on Mali, and then we can discuss maybe later about it. Mali has been in war, in civil war. The war that we had in Mali, but that we call a terrorist war, because it is a terrorist war. But in the same time, I think it's very important to understand the historical background. With colonization, people from different backgrounds were put together as one state. And people of the north of Mali, and people in the southern part of that Sahara Desert, were people from different ethnic groups that the French would say, okay, that from different tribes, and then they say the north is white, and the south is black. I don't have ever seen someone from northern Mali. They wouldn't be black if they were running in the streets they wouldn't be white if they were running in the street of New York or in the street of London. But race was used. But in fact, it was a political struggle. It was, let's say, maybe a nationalist struggle. But what happened? It happened at a place where religion was used as a political tool. So because what, let's say, nationalists in northern parts of the country used in order to get to split the country into two was, we want Sharia, because the way that they use, to be the basic law of the country. As Nadia showed, that in Tunisia, where they talk about, we are a Muslim country, we need the law of God run the country. It was something which was something that very important in understanding what happened in Mali, and it was a real backlash against laicity.
Thank you.